Welcome back to the podcast, Conversations with Jeff Bucknam. Jeff Bucknam is the lead pastor of teaching and vision at Harvest Bible Chapel in Chicago. And I am Wesley Cassford, filling in for Tommy Creutz.
Do you know, every time one of you guys says lead pastor of teaching and vision, you know what comes to my mind is this guy I used to know who was, he was an Indian guy and he had a mission, he had a ministry in Canada. And he used to say, I heard him give a sermon once, and his sermon was about vision and how you need to have vision. And it was we'd always tease him, and he always took it. It was like, yes, you must have vision, more vision, which I think would be much better title.
Yeah.
The lead pastor of teaching and vision.
We could probably change that.
Oh, it'd be excellent.
We know some people. We were just talking about so many things before this.
We are. Wesley, I got a question for you.
Tell me.
So you are a parent of a toddler.
Yeah.
How old is Henry?
He just turned two in April.
Give us an update regarding what's happening in the life of a parent with a two-year-old in 2024.
A parent?
Do you know what I mean? What's it like to parent a two-year-old right now? Do you have all the gadgetry at home? Do you have swings and stuff that swing themselves?
We did when he was like an infant.
Okay.
He has been off the charts his entire life as far as size and all of the categories, size, head circumference, all of the other things, weight, height. And so he wears like 4 and 5 year old clothing and he's like a 2 year old.
Nice. Dude, this guy sounds like he might end up being an offensive lineman.
He's a big guy. Yeah. He's really good at baseball. As good as you can be. His two-year-old.
He hits dingers.
He hits dingers. He's got the double play down. Shortstop for sure.
He's a little big for shortstop.
Yeah, well,
but you know that's fine. Okay.
He can reach. Maybe first base.
Well, I was going to say, if you can get him over first base,
yeah,
and you can teach him how to hit lefty,
yeah,
now you're talking.
That's all you need. So as a parent, he's great. I think there's a lot of little gadgets. We don't do any of the... he doesn't have like his own device of any kind.
Okay.
He'll watch some stuff.
Is that a thing? Your friends and stuff have the same age kids? Are they already into the iPads?
I know some people that have tablets, yeah.
Mm.
I don't know about that young, older.
It brings a kind of serenity to the parents.
Oh, definitely.
That is hard to pass up.
Now, what I do...
I'm not saying that it's something you should do, but I'm just saying that when they sit there with it and there's peace and quiet, you're like, yep. Whoa, this is a special kind of thing.
Yeah. What we do is we'll save it for emergencies. Like when you're at dinner with like, you know, a nice place, yeah. Olive Garden, you know, the nicest there is. And he's like losing it. It's like, would you like to play your game? And he's like, of course.
Oh yeah. That's and like we,
the best game. I think it's called Smash Master. Okay. There's these bugs that just crawl around, little cartoon bugs, and you just smash them all.
Perfect.
He loves it.
This is the perfect game.
Hours. Except for when he hits an ad. Then he's like, Dad, I'm trying to buy like a Honda Civic.
Yeah.
Like, no.
Don't buy the Civic, son.
Yeah, don't do that. I'm like, I don't care how much it costs. Like, I'm getting rid of the
ads.
But yeah, we'll do that. But yeah, there's a lot of...
Do you have a big bulky stroller? Do you have like one that can go off-road and stuff?
I would like one, like the big wagon.
I don't know. Is that a thing?
I would. He's outgrowing, so he had the stroller that his little baby
car seat
just went in. And then he comes out of the car, goes straight in, and then...
They didn't have that when I was... used to always have to transfer the kid out of their seat to the other
thing. Now they have one that the car seat is the stroller. It comes out, you push a button, and wheels and a handle come out.
Go, go, gadget.
Exactly. But ours clipped in, and then now he has the seat, but he's like out. He's like spilling out of that because he's the size of a five-year-old. So we're probably going to have to find something soon.
I was going to say, what are you going to do?
There's a...
is there a special website for giant children?
No, I think you just go up sizes. I can't think of what it's called. We go there all the time. It's the Red Wagon Company. I don't know what they're called.
Okay. Radio Flyer. We've got
Radio Flyer. That's it. Yeah, yeah. They have tons and tons of varieties of big wagons and off-road, like you said, the big wheels. And
nice.
That's what I want. I don't want it to like tip over and crack.
No. You want one that's going to be...
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
But the thing that I've noticed as we have been parenting and like been around the general populace is there's a lot more gadgets, not like technology, but like things that are helpful that like my parents didn't have.
Yeah.
Well, like a little sound machine that could fit in my pocket.
Right.
Or obviously like cell phones and stuff, but like that sort of thing. Or like he has this bib that is just like a big, it's like a big reservoir at the bottom.
Yeah.
Catches all the like stuff. Who,
why didn't they think like, of this before?
Yeah, exactly. He has plates that have suction cups on the bottom. So right. You can't like throw it off the thing. Yes. And like, there's a lot of little things like that are like super helpful.
So we were sitting next to this, this woman who just had, her second or third child. And, she was, my wife was talking to her and she was looking on her phone at a live picture of her child
yep.
in some location. And she could switch between cameras and talk to the child
yep.
through the phone while yep. she was like out and about, which of course you could do, right? It's like yep. a Zoom call or whatever. But her face, she had it in her room that her face could come up on a big screen.
Oh, wow. That's next level.
If, you know, hey, it's okay, honey, right. I'm right here. Now, that was not a thing.
The ghost of mommy is
no,
right here.
No, that was not
yeah, we
a
have,
thing.
We have a monitor. I can look at it on my phone. And then we have like the little unit.
Do you place the monitor screen. In all sorts of other locations just to freak people out? Is there one in this room right now?
No. The thing I will do, my wife does not do anything scary. Like we'll do like Halloween spooky, but not like scary. We watched The Shining with some friends one time.
It's a little scary.
Yeah. She was under a blanket the whole time. So when she'll go, sometimes when she'll get up in the middle of the night to go check on our son, I'll lean over and grab the little monitor and I'll push the button. That's red rum. So while she's in the dead of night trying to get our son red rum, she'll come back in like, what was that? So that's about the extent of what, or when there's a babysitter. And I'll be like, oh, I wonder if they're going down.
Is that what it's for, kind of, though, is to check on the babysitter? Make sure the babysitter's doing what they're supposed to be doing?
It is actually super helpful. It is helpful for that, but it's also helpful for when he's sleeping and he's, like, crying in the middle of the night. You can check and be like, oh, he threw his pacifier across the room. Okay. Like, I can see that. Or, oh, his arm is stuck in the bar.
Yeah.
Or if it's like, oh, he's just crying, just leave him be.
So there's a Black Mirror episode.
Oh, yeah.
About this... a device that's like, you know, Life 360 mm-hmm. that people have. That's like that, where you can track your kid, but the way that you track it is it's an implant in their brain that you can see what they see at that moment. Oh, so you're actually looking through their eyes, and then you have it on your little, you have it on your iPad or whatever it is that you're working with there, or your phone. And so you can track them through. And you can even adjust things in their head so that they don't hear certain noises because they might be afraid of the dog that's barking.
Sure.
You can muffle the dog. Anyway, yeah, so this is what your kid is now. You're manipulating your child's brain.
Yeah. When he's in his room.
Talk about a helicopter parenting, dude. That's amazing. That's not helicopter. That's parasite parenting.
Yeah.
With them the whole time.
And you can, make decisions for them.
That's
the worst part about parenting.
Have you ever seen the show Misery, the movie Misery?
No. I was going to make a joke
little bit
about
scary one.
That's my life.
Misery.
No, I'm just kidding.
It's basically about this lady who's a nut. Case fan of an author, and the author ends up getting in a car accident near her house. She brings him back to her house and she basically holds him as hostage. But it's much better than the way I just said it. Kathy Bates, actually her best role. Yeah, I think there's a lot of parents that are basically the lady in Misery now. they're psycho because they want they just are right on top of the people all the time and little kids, and don't let them do this and that.
Well, I learned early that you can only do so much. You can do everything you can. You have to let it go.
Yeah.
They will do things that you don't want them to.
Oh, totally. It's a lion. They're going
to
have to play with that lion.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, at some point, they're going to have to get in that car with that leopard.
It's true.
All right. This has been really fun. Thank you very much for talking to me.
Yeah.
You know, Tommy was supposed to be here today. Tommy Two Tons was supposed to come today, and he just didn't even show up. He pulled the Tommy on us.
That's tough when there's a term named after you. Supposedly he's sick.
Wow.
I hope that he is doing well regardless of the trueness of that fact. But yeah, but we have a conversation today because we believe everyone has a story. And today you're talking to Mark Humpa, mm-hmm. works at the Rolling Meadows campus. So we should get into that right now. Let's go. Get better, Tommy.
Sitting across from Mark Humpa. Mark, what's your middle name?
Matthew.
Mark Matthew John Luke Humpa.
It would be if my parents had that way.
Is it? Did you grow up in like a really...
Yeah, first Roman, of all, Roman Catholic.
What do you do here?
I'm the operations manager for the Eastern campuses.
Okay. So the Eastern campuses are the Cathedral, mm-hmm. Rolling Meadows, and North Shore.
Correct.
Okay. So your parents, you grew up Catholic.
Yeah, yeah.
And so they wanted to name you after all of the...
Did the whole thing. You know, infant baptism, confirmation, all of that.
Really?
Yeah.
What are your memories of the... Like when you stop and you think about your time as in the Roman Catholic Church, what are the memories that from flooding back to your head, things that you see?
Now, it was a lot of... just kind of repetitive singing, repetitive prayer.
Do you know all the prayers? Like right now you could do them all.
But when I go to weddings and we go to Roman Catholic weddings, it brings back flashes of my youth, you know, doing this.
Committed Roman Catholic family then.
Yeah.
Well, like church every week? I mean, mass?
Oh, yeah. 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 And they, my parents, when I was younger, they kind of started off in a gymnasium, and then they kind of were one of the first families in this Roman Catholic church in Schaumburg.
Wow. What's the name of the church?
Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit. Okay. Yeah. I ride my bike by Holy Family.
Yeah, no.
Almost every day.
I know that one.
Yeah. I've never seen it. I've never seen one called the Holy Family before. Yeah. It's pretty inclusive.
There's a big acrylic Jesus in that church.
Is there?
It's a gigantic Jesus. It looks like it's made of ice.
Really?
Yeah, I know that one.
Okay. It's interesting. Beautiful building.
Yeah.
That building is beautiful. Yeah, no question about it. It's a nice little spot off Palatine Road there.
Right.
So you have brothers and sisters?
I have sister Julie. She's 4 years younger than me. That's it.
Okay. So, you are the all-American family.
Yeah, we were, I mean...
Two-point whatever kids.
You'd have a hard time writing a blues song about my upbringing. I mean, it was very vanilla. I mean, I grew up in Schaumburg. My dad was in sales. My mom was a travel agent.
Really?
Yeah.
Did you travel a lot?
She did. I didn't. Once in a while, we would, she would bring me along.
Okay. What was the most exciting place you went with her?
She took me on a Disney cruise one time. It was really nice.
Really?
By
the way, what is different about Disney cruises to the rest of the cruises?
Yeah, they have their own private island. Everything's just Disney themed. But now it's, I don't know.
When you're on the boat, there are like Disney characters everywhere?
Yeah, they got all Disney. Everything's Disney themed.
Okay. You know?
It's just like Disney World on water.
Okay.
Without the rides, I
guess. So you enjoyed that?
Yeah.
All right.
It was good.
Where'd you go?
We went, I think it was Bahamas. This was a while ago. We went around there, went to a private island.
Well, you're a young man though. Not that long ago.
Oh, please.
Few years ago. How old are you?
55.
50. You're old man.
I am old man.
Actually, you're a young man.
It's all right.
I'm 51. So I'm feeling, when I'm a rock crossing you now, I feel
you're young.
Better.
Yeah. I know. Better now. Less gray hair.
That's great. So you've always lived in Chicago your whole life.
Well, I lived in Chicago when I was in college. I went to Columbia College.
Where are you from?
At the rough and tumble streets of Schaumburg.
Yeah, but that's my thing. So then you went to college?
Columbia College in Chicago, which was...
Oh, sorry. I didn't ask it the right way. Every time I talk to people from Chicagoland...
Yeah.
Yeah. When I said you lived in Chicago your whole life, you're like, well... When I was in college. But what I meant was Chicagoland. You've lived in Chicagoland your whole life.
Little bit time I spent I lived a little bit north of Dallas in Denton for a little bit.
Why?
I had a job opportunity there, and I had friends that went to school there.
Okay.
So it was cheaper than living in Dallas, and then I would you know.
Denton, Texas.
Yeah.
Denton is, so when I went to seminary in Dallas.
Okay. Yeah.
And when I went to seminary in the late 1990s, Denton was like its separate spot from Dallas-Fort Worth. And now it's not. Now it's like all Dallas-Fort Worth.
Yeah.
You drive and you don't know where honestly, like Schaumburg is the same thing basically as whatever, Des Plaines, which is just down the road, I guess, and where the airport is. We wouldn't know. If you're from out of town, you'd be like, I don't know where.
Right, right.
Yeah. So, but now Denton is all, absorbed.
Yeah, it was very, I don't know, it was a hippie vibe. I just came down there to
from
live.
From Denton?
No, Denton was. The people, the students that I hung out with down there.
Because they were at
Northern
Texas. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I would drive down to a part of Dallas, was Deep Ellum.
Yeah, it was right around the corner from where I lived.
Yeah, so that was kind of the art scene back there in the early 90s. So I would kind of get jobs over there as an assistant photographer.
Okay. So what were you interested in when you were a kid? What kinds of stuff? I mean, you Catholic kid going to, but when you weren't in, when you weren't saying your Hail Marys,
yeah, right.
What were you doing?
I did a lot of skiing, downhill skiing, winter, believe it or not.
I'm sorry. That's just weird to me.
I know. They call us Flatlanders here.
Yeah. Cause you are, and there's no ski. People tell me, oh, there was skiing here. And I'm like, where?
Yeah.
There's no
skiing. Wisconsin. You got to go a little north.
Okay, but I've been in Wisconsin, and there's still little tiny hills.
And that's what you have. But occasionally, my parents got me. We would go out to, like, Mammoth Mountain in California.
Yes.
Go to Breckenridge once in
nice.
A while.
Things so like you'd go that. To the big, big
once
hills.
In a while. That was special.
Okay. But nice. So how often would you ski?
Every weekend when I was up until about 16 or so, yeah.
Where were you skiing every weekend?
We would go to Devil's Head, Alpine Valley, Wilmot. I know these little places. Okay. Once in a while, we'd go, my parents every year, we'd go to a place up in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan called, now it's escaping me, that we did that. We would go to Big Powderhorn Mountain, was it called. And so I had a ski teacher there, and this was funny. His name was Bing Bang. He was like a Swedish, Norwegian, but Bing was his first name. Bang was his last name. And I learned how to ski at the Bing Bang Ski School. So it was kind of.
It looks like, sounds like a stage name.
No,
but that's okay. I love it, right? Maybe his first name was Bjorn.
Maybe.
Bjorn Bing Bang. Okay. Are you a good skier today?
I haven't skied in a long time. No. Then I started to drive and.
That was
and,
it.
And date and.
When I got to 16, I abandoned
basically,
it.
Basically. Yeah, that was it. You know,
you could go faster on. In a car.
Yeah, basically. But I thought I had visions of being like an Olympic downhill skier. I
mean, really? Were you fast back in those days?
I would compete and I would, yeah.
Really? You like actually competed?
Yeah, they had time things and yeah.
Was it just downhill that you did or were you like giant slalom?
Just
slalom?
Downhill. I loved it.
Just go as fast as you can.
My parents would hate it. They'd go, enjoy you were here for a trip. Enjoy it. And I would just get to the top of the mountain and just. As fast as I could get down.
You just bomb down as fast
as you
can.
Just go down, yeah.
That's great. So if I took you skiing today, though, you'd be fine.
I could pick it up, sure.
Yeah, you'd remember.
You can take me skiing.
Yeah. Do you have skis?
I don't, but
I don't either.
If we were to go, I'd find a way.
So back in the day when you were skiing, similar to me, you remember they had those super long, skinny ones. Now they don't do that.
Yeah, they were 210s or something.
Like, yeah, short, fat things going.
Yeah.
It's funny, too, because every once in a while on the hill, you'd see somebody with the old long skis and you'd give them a nod like, yeah, I remember when we worked on those ones.
Right. Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
You'd have to go wax them, get them all ready.
Oh my goodness. Yeah. Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. I grew up, kind of near a ski hill. I would ski sometimes two, three times a week because of where we lived. It was about 45 minutes from actually a pretty significant, hill. So that was fun.
Yeah.
I remember those days of driving up late in the afternoon to go night skiing.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah. Night skiing is one of those things that, it scares the living daylights out of you a little bit because, if you stay, if you have any guts at all, you're going to wander a little bit off the lighted run.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Run into a tree.
And you're basically,
that makes it exciting, right?
Your life into your hands at that point. Yeah. Okay. So your sister, 4 years younger
right.
than you. You always got along with her? You were a good big brother?
I knocked her tooth out one time.
Because you were angry or just because
we were kids and she got into my room or something and she was trying to do something. I don't remember. And I kicked her in the mouth and out came her tooth.
Wow. So how'd that go down with mom and dad?
Yeah, we were over it now. It took 30 years maybe, but we're close, my sister and I, so we're good.
So what was it like growing up in Schaumburg in the 19, I guess for you, in the 80s?
Yeah.
Like what'd you do on a weekend?
Go to the mall.
The Woodfield Mall.
Woodfield Mall. And yeah, that was
the main. Was it the same then as it is now?
Even bigger because, you know, malls now are dying.
Yeah.
But that was the big hangout place. Or there was a place in Hoffman Estates. It was called Barrington Square. And that was a place. They had a movie theater there and pizza, you know, record stores, all this kind
Where
of stuff.
Where was that located?
Because Barrington Road and 72 and Higgins.
Oh, okay. So that's where kind of near the, well, down there, 59 and Higgins is Arboretum and stuff.
Though, yeah.
But further back
right.
Toward Barrington Road. Okay. And so there's a big shopping area there.
And there used to be a big concert venue. And if people have been here for a while, I remember Poplar Creek Music Theater. In fact, that's where I had my high school graduation there.
Okay.
And it was a place where you could just, it was so close to our house and you could see concerts. They were cheap. It was all the big names. It's
really,
it's not there anymore, but you know,
how many concerts did you go to?
Oh, I went to so many. It was
all right. Biggest. First of all, I want to know the biggest name concert or the one you remember the best. And then I also want to know what were the one that you had the best seats at so that you could feel the sweat from.
So something you might not know, I'm a big 80s new wave king of all of that stuff. So
all right.
If it's 80s new wave, I'm the expert.
Okay, describe
that.
It. So when you say 80s new wave, what are you saying to people here? English beat?
Oh, I've seen them in concert. I've seen them, yes.
I thought you had not. It's a pretty obscure reference.
No, I might. You know, one of the ones I remember being, I was with a date and we went to see Oingo Boingo.
Oink.
And Oingo Boingo. And she got crushed on this, you know, we were way up front. It was a general admission and she got crushed and on the stage and they had to pull her up on stage and I lost her for the rest of the show. I met her afterwards. I'm like, I hope you enjoyed it because, you know, aside from being crushed, you know, against the stage, you know, when the band Oingo Boingo. Played.
Yeah. All right. Who else? You big Depeche Mode guy then.
I like them. Yeah. They're, you know, as I get older, you know, Police are my number one band.
Really?
I love them.
Of all time.
And the Cars. Those were my two big bands I listened to.
So I'm like, I have the mother of all playlists on my, I do on Spotify. And there's quite a few Cars songs on there.
Yeah.
Magic is probably the best Cars song that I like.
You liked it?
I did. Because you're probably a big enough Cars fan to not like the popular ones.
No, they're all
but
fine.
That was a pretty good one.
I put them on my shuffle when I'm at the gym and they pop. You know, I still like them all.
There you go. And the Police, really?
Oh, big time, yeah.
Roxanne.
Yeah, all that.
Message in a Bottle.
Yeah.
Which is the best Police song ever.
Oh, gosh, I don't even
know. And how do you feel about Sting going solo? Is it good? Do you remember the night that late '80s album where he,
I think
know,
he's calling it in now. He used to put out really good music. And then he just sort of, now he just sort of plays his old stuff over and over. It still charges like
a lot of money,
$200 a ticket to hear him play the same stuff he's been playing for 20 years.
I hope the Russians love their children too.
Yeah.
Don't they or whatever.
Yeah, it was all good. But yeah, I don't know. I think there's a point where.
So if I go into your car and we turn it on, are the Police, you're listening to Police right now?
No, you'd probably hear Fleetwood Mac right now, even though it's not new wave, but I had it, you know, I do like classic rock too. So I have to, that's why a lot of these bands.
So classic rock though, is it, these bands are from the early 80s. Fleetwood Mac certainly is.
Yeah.
Oingo Boingo, actually, it's not a good boy. It's kind of in the mid 80s.
Yeah.
You were a Duran Duran fan.
I saw them in concert in 85.
Yeah. And?
Yeah, they were okay. I mean, it was great when I was like 16 and I saw them because it was full of young girls, you know,
yeah,
and I'm like, I go there with my cousin and I'm like, well, look at the odds of guys to gals here.
Yeah. Well, they weren't there for you.
Yeah, I know. But well,
okay. So a lot right into your music then. Did you have a Flock of Seagulls haircut?
No, but I, you know what I did?
Can you explain what that is to people?
Yeah. It looks like a big, like wave. Like if you had a big tidal wave on your forehead, you know, coming off your head, that's basically what it was. It was blonde, you know, but what I did was I took my mom wouldn't let me do like goofy stuff. So I got peroxide.
Did you?
And I bleached the sides of my hair until it was like until I had big stripes on the sides of my hair. Yeah.
Yeah. Did you have a mullet at one point in your life?
No, I got an earring. I didn't tell my mother, and I had to pick her up from work one time, and it was on the left side ear. Uh-huh. And I remember just always kind of looking at her kind of with my head on the right side. Like, right. I wouldn't look her straight on as long as I could. And, you know, and she was not happy with that.
But when she found out that you had the earring.
I got an earring too. Yeah. But that was the style. Parachute pants.
Oh, you know, parachute pants.
Leather ties.
They were terrible. Yeah. Wow. This is we could reminisce for a long time about the music. Yeah. My favorite band, well, it was my favorite band, but I got addicted to A-ha for a little while.
Okay.
There. Yeah. 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 And Tears for Fears was, of course, I'm 5 years younger than you, 4 years younger than you. So some of the mid to late 80s would be more
but
my
cup of tea. I'm
going
to go see Hoodoo Gurus in September.
Are you?
Crowded House in September. Yeah.
Dude, you know Kiwis, the Crowded House, the New Zealanders.
They made some of the band, Midnight Oil. I saw the them. I love them. They're great bands. Yeah. Yeah. The Vinyls,
For those of you out there, you need to go and do some Spotifying of Midnight Oil. Now you're talking.
Yeah, that's very political.
That's some good stuff. Well, back in those days,
yeah.
Now nobody knows what they're talking about. Well, you too. See, I grew up in a kind of Protestant, the equivalent of your Catholic. I grew up in the Protestant house where we'd go to church, but I didn't understand it, really repetitive and all that kind of stuff. And the church wasn't really a gospel preaching church, and so I remember going to all that, but then when I came to faith in Christ, they made me hand in all my music, which really it was hard for me to do that. I mean, I was all for it because I was like, okay, like if Sting is terrible, then fine. So you hand in all the music, but the one that they let you have was U2. Because apparently they were supposedly Christian, Christians, and Bono would sing songs, you know, that had biblical references and things in them, so you could have it. So U2 is my lifeline to actual music. Not that some of the Christian music wasn't okay, but it was like, you know, it in the early days, it was sort of, you know, C-rated music.
Yeah. I'm even conflicted sometimes now when I listen to old stuff and, you know, there's certain songs from certain bands I hear and I'm like, I'm going to skip that one.
That's not a song that I, right. I remember when I was a kid, when I was young and I was not, wasn't really Christian yet, but the Jay Giles Band was one that I listened to. And you listen to this stuff, which of course you should have known Centerfold at the time was about something. But I don't know why it just didn't occur to me. And then it probably had been about 5-10 years ago. I was like, oh, yeah, this song. And I was like, okay. That's not probably what I was thinking.
Right,
but that happens
to
a lot of people, I think, when they listen to the music that they listen to their youth because they just didn't know what they were singing about at all.
Yeah.
And I find myself listening to the lyrics now of all the different songs now going, oh, that's what that's about. That's actually a pretty good song.
Yeah, I know. I get disappointed when I find out something's totally different about what I thought it was and it's something bad. And then I don't think I can listen to that anymore. Goodbye.
There you go.
You know, but whatever.
So went to college at Columbia, which is an art school.
Yeah. Oh, you know it.
Yeah. What were you planning on doing in the
city? Photography. I got my degree in photography.
Did you? Yeah. When did you get interested in photography?
I took a high school class, like photo one and photo two, and that's all they offered. And I really excelled in it. And I had a really supportive
teacher. Does it mean to excel in photography?
Like you keep like wanting to photograph more and different things, and you go deeper, and they would give you like silly assignments, like photograph something that's black and white, photograph it, you know, do it. But then I'm like, well, let's take it to another level. Let's do, you know, something that's got all these color schemes and, you know, and so these were the days when we had chemistry. It was not digital.
Yeah.
So I'm surprised I don't have like 6 fingers from sticking my fingers in the chemistry and everything all those years. But after I did the 2 years of photography, I had a teacher said, you know, I'm going to make a special class for you. You can take it, you know, your whole time that you're here. I'll have a private kind of like study for you. And she would give me assignments and we'd, you know, do that. So it was great. And then I was like,
do you have your own dark room and things?
No, I don't.
You had to use the school's one.
School one. Yeah. Yeah, and then I was like, well, wow, I can maybe make money at this, right?
So when was the what was the first picture you sold or the first thing that you made money at when you were?
Oh, wow, that's a good question. Wow. I would get hired to do, when I was in college, I would get people that wanted to be models and things like that.
Yeah.
And they would hire me to do like composites. Like they're like, hey, I'm look, want to be a model. Can you take me in the studio? And I've got these different outfits. Can you photograph me? I got to look business. I need one that looks like this. You know, and I would do that. And I would work with a lot of kind of.
Did some headshots there?
Did headshots. Yeah, that was part of it. So that was kind of, that was fun.
Okay.
Yeah. You get to work with pretty people. Yeah,
sure. Yeah, absolutely. You should be a lemur. You are a lemur, not a tiger.
Basically, that was it. Yeah.
What music did you play in the background to try to encourage the Oingo Boingo?
No, I'd probably be something more like low key, like Sade or something. You know, just kind of like, okay.
Put them at ease.
Yeah,
that's exactly right. Like a little Enya in the background, yeah. Make them feel.
Yeah, just kind of cool. Just relax. Yeah.
That's
And then we used to almost joke. We'd say, you know, just you shoot the first like 30 or 40 pictures with no film in the camera just to make them feel comfortable.
Yeah,
and
then
you put it in and then you start shooting. Yeah, that's what I used to do.
So when you went to school, you were planning on becoming a professional photographer. Were you still hoping to do the same kind of work, like professional photographer and weddings or these sorts of things? Or did you want to work for a magazine back in those days, which is, I think, was kind of the pinnacle of it. I mean, if you were a photographer. So,
which is part of my testimony a little bit, where I wanted, you know, to be a fashion photographer because, again, I started doing like model shoots and I thought, oh, I keep working with these good looking people and I'm getting paid. And then they would invite me to parties and things like this after, you know, and like, man, maybe I could go to exotic places. And, you know, it was very, you know, superficial, but, you know, when you're 21, 22, you're like, yeah,
that's what you want to do.
You're like, this is great. And I was just kind of doing that. That's what I thought I was going to do. I was going to just, you know, you work your way up as an assistant and do that. And, I was living a lifestyle though that I couldn't afford because you'd go out and you'd want to wear the fancy clothes and you'd want to go to the fancy places and, fancy car, you know, all this stuff. And, I was working at a job, you know, I was working as an assistant trying to make it in the business, but I was also embezzling money at a company I was at. Okay. So
wait, yeah, what?
I'll take it. I'll take you down a dark road.
I want to go down.
Happy
that
now we're going to go dark.
Yeah.
And I was just trying to afford this.
How were you embezzling money? What were, like?
So I was working for a company where I was in charge of the books and inventory and things like that. And I used, you know, I wasn't close to the Lord. No. I just, after I was in college, I just sort of just was like, I believe in Jesus. If you ask me, but nobody would know it if you saw me, mm-hmm. you know, if you didn't know who I was, you know, but if you said you believe in it, yeah, I do. But, so I worked for a company, I would play with inventory and I started taking a little bit of money just to live this lifestyle. Mm. And then I took a little more.
What was the first time you did that?
When?
Well, yeah, I've always kind of wondered what justified. Are you justifying it in your mind?
Well, yeah, I would just say, well, it's just a little bit of money. And I would say, you know, they treated me bad, you know, and they should, I didn't get that raise I was supposed to get. And I didn't get, you know, and you just sort of just, you do that. And so that's kind of how you do it. And then I did it and I got away with it and I did it again. And I, you know, and I was like, I keep getting away with this. And I was doing a little bit more and a little bit more. And I was like, okay, I can't keep doing this. So I ended up working, ironically, as a purchasing agent now, a purchasing manager at a different company I left. And it was a few months into that job when I came home and I was living in Aurora at the time. And I pulled into my house in my driveway and a car pulls up behind me and out come two police detectives. And they said, get in the back of the, you know, they flashed their badges and they're like, get in the back of the car. We want to talk to you. And they said, we know what you did. And I'm just playing dumb, even though I'm like, what are you talking about? You know, and they showed me all the evidence. And when they told me how they found it, it was, I didn't know at the time, it was like a 1 in a million fluke chance, but it was the Lord really just was like, I've had enough of you doing what you're doing and living like this and doing this. And They said, well, so I admitted it. I told them, yeah, okay, I did it. I did it. And they said, well, we're going to go back to your employer and we're going to go and see if he's going to press charges. Mm-hmm. And so I had a few days there where I didn't know what was going to happen. And my wife had no idea what was going on. I mean, I was married at this time and I'm like, she's going to divorce me when I tell her, you know, if I tell her. And the next day I came to work and I just cried at my desk. I just was like, what have I become? You know, how did I become this person that was doing this? And I called her up and I'm like, it is what it is. I'm just going to tell her. And I told her and no condemnation. She's like, she was working as a photographer at a newspaper nearby. And so she said, come here after work. And so we talked and, you know, she was the one that led me to the Lord, led me back.
Wow.
And I had to go to court. I admitted it. It was a felony conviction because it was over $1,000. And I got, the Lord was good to me. I got 2 years probation and 40 hours of community service, which is ironic because now I work with a lot of people doing community service here at the church.
You're like, hey, I've been there.
But the good news, what was really sweet about this is some years later, I was working or I was managing a group, a Christian Business Fellowship. I don't know if you've heard that here. I don't know if they even have that at Harvest, but they, it's for business owners and they have their own, it's like you could be a sole proprietor or own a multi-million dollar company. They get together like a small group and then we break into smaller groups and talk about problems. And one of the guys in my group was a lawyer and he said, you know, I think I told him my testimony about this. And I said, you know, this has been years. It's been a one-time thing, but it hangs over my head and it's just, you know, I accept it, but you know, it's just still this one-time mistake, but it led me to the Lord. Mm. He says, I think I can do something about it. And I was like, okay, you're just being nice, but okay, sure, thanks, you know. And 3 years later, I was in front of a committee, and he's like, I'm going to get you a full pardon from the governor. He goes, my lawyer. So I was in front of this committee, and they go, okay, why should we pardon you? You know, why should we give this to the governor? And, you know, I had friends there, character witnesses and things like that, and we talked, and I said, okay. So I said to my lawyer, this was in April. I said, when should I get an answer? And he's like, probably within 90 days. So, you know, May comes nothing, June nothing, July nothing. I'm like, okay, well, this is Illinois. It's government. Yep. the wheels don't turn too fast. And then it was August, September, nothing. And I'm like, well, I guess I didn't get it, but I gave it a shot. And then December comes along and I got a notice from the governor that he had fully pardoned me from that.
Merry Christmas.
Yeah. So I got, that was kind of a sweet thing.
It is. Yeah. So expunged from your record and
totally gone. Not even, even better than that. It's like, well, it never existed.
Yeah.
It's not even a sealed record. It's just gone.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
So when did you get married?
I got married in 94. We got married in St. Thomas in the Virgin Islands. You've got a son that's getting married. So maybe you know this. We were going to have a wedding here and it was just getting so just, you know, so many people giving advice, so expensive. So it was just a headache. And we said, you know, we're not going to elope. We're going to go there. We're just going to get married. Yeah. And then we'll come back and just have a small little reception. But if you want to go there, if you want to fly out there and see us, great. We'll be there. Here's the time and place. And so it was just the two of us.
Yeah.
And then we came back and had a small reception. So I'm glad we did it. Even after all these years, I thought I might regret it. But no, I'm glad we did what we did.
Yeah. I wish my kids
saw that. That was 30 years ago. Yeah,
I'm kidding. Well, it's almost 30. This year is 30 years ago.
Yeah, May 5th.
Okay. What? So you just had your
30th.
Like days ago, 30th anniversary. Congratulations, man. That's fantastic. And was she a Christian when you got married?
Yeah, she was. And it caused a little strife with her mom, especially because we were, you know, unequally yoked, as the saying goes.
Yeah.
You know,
where'd you meet her?
I met her at work. I was working at a photo lab at Woodfield Mall.
Oh yeah.
I'd come back from Texas and I was just like, I just need some job. So I got there and she had worked there previously, but left. And she came in and she's like, hey, I'd like to get my job back. And I'm looking for the old manager. And I was like, well, she's not here, but you know, I'll let her know. And later when I saw my manager, I'm like, who is that? I'm like, you got to hire her.
Yeah.
Get her here right now. Hire her. You know, and my wife hated me when I met her. I was a pest and I was just always hanging on her. And
yeah.
She had a boyfriend at the time and I was bad because every time he would treat her bad or something, I'd be like, I'd never do that. Why do you put up with that? Why would you even put up with, you know? So I was just kind of like getting my digs in.
Yeah.
So finally when they did break up, I was like, well, would you like to go out for dinner?
Yeah. That's great.
Yeah.
And how long did you date before you got married?
2 years.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then you came, you kind of came to back to faith in Christ, or to faith in Christ.
Yeah.
How would you describe that? I mean, like, was it coming back to faith for you in that regard, or was it more like,
like under the Roman Catholic, you're not really, you know, it's different.
Yeah.
You know, I never really made up,
yeah, doctrinally, it's very different.
Yeah. I think we've even briefly talked about this in the past, but, it just wasn't like a, actually being Catholic feels like being like Irish. You just, when you're born into it, it's sort of like, well, you're born into it, so you're just Catholic. Yeah. And that's how it was kind of always, you know, kind of presented to me.
Yeah.
Where here I had to actually, like, you know, make this public profession, mm-hmm. at least to her at the time. And then, you know, I went through baptism, you know, a couple of years later and did that and made that big profession here to the church, you know, here at Harvest. And
you started attending Harvest in the late...
Right after, 99.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so, and then...
Why?
Well...
Like what
my
was
mother-in-law was going here, you know, she was here for a long time. And I had, when I was dating my wife, she wanted me to go see Harvest when it was still at the high school. So I attended a couple of times when it was in Rolling Meadows High School. And I was like, okay, that's nice. You know, you got your thing and I got mine, you know. And I never really thought much about it, but after, you know, I'd accepted Christ, I just started attending and just haven't stopped since, you know, since
a long time.
I mean, this is and you've got
25 years.
Yeah. You know, and
ups and downs and
I've seen a lot.
Yeah. Okay. So, but I mean, you work for the church now, but you, what are the other jobs that you've done?
Oh,
like you've got a ton of them. So I want to know.
Yeah.
Let's list them off.
I just did a lot of sales. I mean, I worked, a lot of sales positions. I worked for one place that was, they did sales and management job fairs. So if you were a company and you wanted to hire salespeople for your company, you would attend these job fairs and I would bring in the companies and then we'd also work on getting you candidates for that. And we would travel all over the country. And that was a lot of fun, especially when you get to go to Florida in like December, you know, you live in Chicago.
How long did you do that job?
That was about 3 years.
Okay.
I had done that. You know, I worked for that job I was embezzling
really?
For a while. I worked.
Then the next job.
Yeah, then the next one. But that one I left on my own. But what happened is after I became, I got convicted of this, I was like, who's going to hire a felon? You know, because it was just like,
yeah.
And that's when my wife and I started our own photography business and it was sort of a part-time thing. And then later it became a full-time thing for at least for me for more than a decade.
Wow.
And so,
what were the photography gigs that you mostly
did? Weddings
that
we did at 1 year. I had about, I think 7 or 8 photographers working for us. We did 300 weddings in 1 year.
Oh my word.
And it was, it's a lot to manage though, because it's creative. And so if you ask say 8 people to draw a picture of a dog, you're going to get 8 different pictures, you know? Mm-hmm. And so, it gets a little hairy sometimes when you're working with that much creativity, you know?
So cats.
we've brought it down. It's basically, you know, obviously I do it now. It's my wife's full-time thing, and she's the main photographer and only photographer really. And I just help with marketing and taxes and that boring stuff, you know, paying bills.
When did you, so for 10 years you were a professional photographer.
Yeah.
And you own your own company. What stopped that? Why did you stop doing it?
Me? Because it hit a lot of ebbs and flows. I mean, it was like we'd have really hot seasons and then you get like crickets at other seasons. And it was just very kind of just hard, unsteady.
I was going to say, that's hard to live with. It's like real estate in some ways.
Looking back at my life, I wouldn't go into photography again. I just wouldn't. It's like a hobby. It'd be like, oh, that'd be a nice hobby. But I'm so deep into it now. And my wife is too, you know, that this is, we've got to make it work. And, there's no benefits to it when you're self-employed. And being self-employed is very lonely. If anybody knows that, it's just one of the loneliest jobs I've had, because while you can enjoy all the successes, when you've got problems and issues, it feels just no one's there to help you. There's no safety net. I've got to figure this out on my own. And that was kind of a big, you know, thing. And I was working out of my house. I didn't interact with a big office staff like we do, say, at Harvest. Mm. So I feel like there's a world out there and I don't know what's going on. I'm not a part of it. You know, I'm stuck in my desk in my house and editing pictures and things like that, you know? So there was a loneliness factor to it as well.
So what did you do, what did you end up doing? Like after you left, what was the work they did? When did you come to Harvest? You came to Harvest.
I came here 3 years ago and I had tried coming to Harvest. I'd applied two other times. So this was like, I started actually just about a month after you started.
Really?
I came on, yeah. I remember.
All right.
I remember introducing myself to you. You won't remember, but you were like, I said, I've got the worst last name. And then you told me about some, I think Mennonites or Amish that had this.
Oh, dude, they had terrible last names.
That's what I still remember.
We don't need to
I remember our first conversation, names. Right. But, yeah. And then, I forgot the question here.
I was just wondering when you, you said that you applied to Harvest.
Yeah, that's right. So then I applied for one place to, be the assistant to a ministry here that worked with missions, things like that. And I knew I was a little short in some areas, but stronger in others, and I didn't get it. And then I tried for when they had Walk in the Word here to be a manager there.
Yeah.
And then that kind of went south shortly after that. And so I was approached by a friend of mine who works here, who does the other campuses, Pete Stanky. Yeah. And he says, why don't you come? We're looking for somebody. And I go like, no, I think I curse myself. The jobs are cursed here at Harvest when I apply.
No kidding.
And I go, I've already done it twice. He's like, just do it. So I came in and I interviewed. And what was sweet about this is I had an interview with somebody I hadn't met before. It was new to me. His name was Joe Nelson. Mm. And but my second interview was with John Smith and Dave Learned, who I'd known for 20 some years. So when I came in to interview with them, it was like interviewing with friends. It felt very natural.
Yeah.
And I liked it. And I was like, well, you've known me for this long. What do you need to know? What do you want to know? I'm an open book. You know, I can't hide anything from you guys because you've seen all of my warts and everything else over the years.
Yeah.
And fortunately, I did something that they wanted me to come on board. So it was a blessing. And hopefully
What's your title now?
Operations manager.
That's right. But East campuses.
Whatever. I was
at the beginning, but I just wanted everybody to hear it again. Operations manager. So what do you, whatever. I mean, you, so when the building falls apart, that's your fault.
Some people think so. Yeah. But then I sort of, you know, well,
they're old.
Yeah. I go, well, we're working on it. We're working on it.
Yeah. My favorite moment actually at Harvest. Well, favorite. I'm a little twisted, so my favorite moments are the ones that don't go well. They just make me laugh about how things don't work out sometimes.
Yeah.
Is that I was finishing my message on the first Christmas I was here, and I was praying just at the end of my little message, and all of a sudden the fire alarm went off. Like it just started howling.
And that was...
And I was like,
okay,
so in the middle of prayer, I said, and we just thank God for fire alarms and the fire department. And so I said, well, I guess we should leave. See you later. So everybody got up in this awkward, like truncated end. They get up and they leave. And apparently the something with the water had gone crazy.
That was a nightmare. I remember I heard about this because I was up in McHenry having Christmas Eve. It was Christmas Eve. Eve dinner.
Yeah.
And I had like taken the first bite in my mouth and I get a 911 call. You got to get back here. And I'm like, what? And I'm like, okay.
What is this church?
And so we had a sprinkler. Yeah. We had a sprinkler in a vestibule. Well, it was like a domino effect. And the heater that heats the vestibule stopped. Which then froze the pipe, which the pipe then exploded, which set the alarm off, which, you know, and it was just like, which then flooded the office area and the carpets. And I was just like, so that
it was pretty funny.
Now I can look back at it and laugh, but at the time.
It was terrible at the time.
Well, you know, the one of the people I was with was like, we looked around, everything was flooded and it was like Christmas Eve. And he goes, well, nothing we can do about it now. Let's just lock up and deal with this later. I said, okay. And that's what we did. And everything worked out in the end.
It's still standing, the place. But wasn't much.
Yeah.
We got some new carpet out of it, though.
We did. We got some new carpet, flooring, some drywall.
Yeah.
So
all's well that ends well.
Yeah.
Always do you like what you do?
I love it.
Yeah.
I love it. I love the people.
And you're, you're the best dressed building guy in the world.
Earlier today, I think we're saying I was out like digging a trench for the water and for this hope garden that we have out back. And I go, they were like, oh, well, you know, we're going to talk with Jeff today. And I was like, oh my gosh, I look like a coal miner. So I did kind of have to spruce up because I was
all right. Bad. Didn't want to look bad. You didn't want to look
like I got to make the operation. People have a, you know, when they think of operations, they think of like, you know.
Yeah, overalls and your hammer and stuff.
I'm trying to change that image if I can a little bit. So we'll see if I can up the image.
You've done very well. if there's one thing that Harvest Bible Chapel staff is known for is their dress standards. And I really have added a lot to that. I dress not well. But this day and age, it's because I've been riding my bike to work and I just don't like carrying stuff in my backpack. So I'm like, you know, whatever the lightest weight clothing is, that's what we're getting today. So, yeah.
I've seen you come in a couple of times.
Yes, on the old bike.
Yep.
And scooter. You like my scooter.
Yeah, it is kind of cool. I don't know how that works on certain days where you're like, you come in and it's sunny and then you got to leave and it's raining. I'm like, I guess you just goes home in the rain.
Yeah, you go for it. You live with it. Hey, listen, like, man, if you're from Vancouver, British Columbia, a little rain's not going to hurt you. It's if that's your attitude, you're going nowhere.
Yeah.
You've
been out there when it's been cold. I've even like, I don't know how he does it.
It's been funny because I will ride my scooter like throughout the year. The only times I won't do it is when it's like minus whatever. But if it gets,
you're adventurous.
If it's go down below freezing, I'll do it for it's like skiing. This is the thing that I rationalize it. It's just like skiing. I wear skiing clothes. I have skiing hat, skiing goggles. I'm skiing. It just happens to be on a scooter. Nice. And, but when people drive by me, I think they're like, what in the world is this dude doing out here in the freezing cold?
Do you get church people that ever see you and just honk?
Some people just honk at me because they're irritated. I don't know why. They do, seriously. People are funny when they drive. You can tell if there's like toot, you know, that's like, hey, how's it going? But other people honk when they go by you because I guess they're irritated. You're riding on the legally on the, like when I ride my bike, I always find it funny that someone will honk at you. I'm like, where do you want me to go? Like, I'm right here on the edge of the road, man.
Yeah.
But I can just
see people just be driving by me like, oh, that's my pastor. That's the guy there with the ski goggles, to work. That's right.
I have had people tell me that they saw me riding or whatever.
Yeah.
I have this goofy orange helmet. So some people.
Yeah.
Know. And I think I'm probably the only one around who does this, but I saw a guy the other day actually who had a very similar scooter to mine. And I was it's spreading.
There you go.
It's spreading. That's one, right? Soon it's going to be everywhere.
Yeah.
Mark, it's been such a pleasure to talk to you.
Yeah, you too. Thank you.
You have kids. I didn't get into your family at all.
I have three kids.
Yeah. Okay. And what are they doing?
I got a son. His name's Dylan. He's in the Air Force in Florida.
Congratulations.
Does he
do anything Air Force-y? For the Air Force?
He loads ammunition on planes, you know. It's a lot. It's like the military. There's a lot of waiting. A lot of just kind of hanging out and just waiting for something to happen.
Yeah.
I got another daughter. She's in Bloomington, Normal area, and down there going to school. And then I got a 15-year-old who just, you know, does what 15-year-olds do.
Boy or girl?
Girl. Sorry. That's two daughters.
So a son and two daughters.
Yeah.
That's fantastic. One living at home then.
She is. Yeah.
Oh, that's fantastic. And you live near the Rolling Meadows campus?
No, I'm actually in Algonquin, so I'm closer to up there. Elgin. But both of these campuses are kind of home. I work at one and attend the other one, too, on Sundays. So it's kind of a...
All right.
You know.
I didn't know you attended the Elgin campus.
Yeah. You were looking at me at CERT. You didn't see me out there.
Stop it.
This weekend.
There are a lot of people who say that. I'm looking right above your head. I'm not looking at you. I'm looking right above you.
I'll have to point you out.
It's one
when
big
I see
blob
it
out there. It's funny because you the only people you actually end up looking at are the ones that are doing something weird,
get up and walk around, or
they'll end up whispering to their friend next to them, which you're like, what do you think? You know, because most people don't know is that when you do any kind of like public, whether you're playing music or you're speaking or anything like that, There's an inner dialogue that goes on that is not the dialogue you're actually using. So you're speaking, but there's also this inner dialogue that's going on too.
Yeah.
So you can be talking about everything and focus right on it, but also be thinking to yourself, I wonder what they're whispering about.
You start doubting,
you start looking around down at yourself, like, is there something going on here? Am I?
It's all positive. Really.
No,
trust me,
it's not. They lean over and look straight at you. I just want you to think about this. If you're sitting by a person right now, I want you to just lean over. I want you to whisper to the person near you and just stare at the other person while you're whispering. Just sit to the third person in the room, just stare at them
and see how they shake your head.
See how they feel about it. And then for some reason, people are like, yeah, but when you're preaching, you're not real. You're like, no, I actually am real. And when you do that, I'm like, oh my gosh, I don't ever want to do this again. I hate that I have to stand up here to begin with. Oh, it's even worse when you're whispering.
Oh, you're awesome at it. That's great.
Yeah.
Really.
Well, you have to forget it.
You do well.
You actually have to just forget about all of that stuff. And you're just like, whatever, I guess.
Yeah.
Whatever.
It's family.
If they don't I don't care.
Exactly. It's family. I mean, it's like, you know, not all family likes me. So no. I just like, but they're family.
I've had lots of, you know, and there's people who always do certain things in the room. Some are sleepers and others are, you know.
Yeah.
And occasionally they'll stay awake and you're like, hey, I'm winning. This is the best sermon ever. This guy's still awake.
It's kind of your barometer of how your sermon's going.
Right. Yeah.
It's great. Totally.
Great to talk to you, Mark. Yeah, thanks so much for serving the Lord here. It's awesome to hear about all that's gone on. Try not to embezzle stuff.
Yeah.
That's the moral to this story.
Yeah. Try not. I think Charlotte will have a problem with that.
Although, what? You're going to embezzle the Hope Garden now?
Take some vegetables.
You take
home?
A couple off the top.
Gosh. Yeah. No. Lesson learned.
Seriously. It's so great to talk to you.
Thank you. You as well.
The rest of you will talk to you next time.